All right, good morning. I'm Greg Downs. I teach now at University of California, Davis, and I'm delighted to be here. I want to thank Matt and all the people at Dickinson for bringing me out, and I want to thank you all for having me here. Not only am I delighted to be here to talk about Reconstruction, but also especially to talk to teachers. Before I went to grad school, I taught 7th to 9th graders, and so I have some sense of both the challenges and excitement of it, and I have a really strong sense on the other side, teaching college, of how much depends upon the work that you all do, and the differences that are obvious between students who've had really thoughtful high school history and social and junior high school history and social studies teaching, and the ones who either haven't had it or didn't absorb it. And so, all of the work that we do in college builds upon and really depends upon the work that you all do. And I'm especially excited to be here to talk about Reconstruction, because I think Reconstruction and the periods right after the Confederate surrender, which is what I'll focus on today, are some of the most important but least understood moments in American history. And there's all kinds of interesting reasons, which I think Eric talked about 2 days ago, about why that is, how it got misremembered, forgotten, reconstructed, the myths of it got remade and repackaged. But I think that we're at a point now where it is really a momentous period, it's a propitious period, to really assess what Reconstruction was and to try and really think about how we convey that to our students and the public at large. The historical work is there, and I think that it's a moment where we can convey it to a broader audience. So along those lines, I'll put in a plug for one other thing that I'm working on, which is working with the National Park System on trying to embed Reconstruction into the National Park Service, which does not yet have a park dedicated to Reconstruction. One of the goals, one of the ideas that they're studying is the idea of creating a park that would be specifically dedicated to Reconstruction, and in fact, one of the sites we visited was at Beaufort, the much debated site of which trees in Beaufort, in the Beaufort-Port Royal line were the ones that they stood under to read the Emancipation Proclamation that Matt just talked about. But as well as many other interesting places that capture the history of Reconstruction. And they're very excited at the idea of trying to make up for this gap in Reconstruction and National Park Service. You see other places that are opening up to it. So I really hope it's a propitious moment to really put Reconstruction into the public agenda. The work that I do is about understanding the period right after the war as a period of enormous transition and also specifically as a period of occupation. And the way that I like to, and I think that this is useful as a way of teaching for a couple of reasons. I think that students, because of the complexity, Reconstruction is hard to teach even at any level, in part because it's super complicated, and in part because the outcome of it is such a mixed bag from our perspective, that it's easy to see it for what it didn't do. If you focus on what it did accomplish, it's easy to look like you're papering over what didn't get done. And in many respects, it seems like a defeat and a disappointment. And that's a very hard thing to figure out how to package well. And so I think people have been trying to develop different ways, frameworks, for helping students to understand how to relate to it and how to open it up. And you heard about Eric talk about it as a revolution, as a second American revolution, an idea that was popular at the time during Reconstruction and has existed in different points of American history, of the second American revolution. And I think Jeff Rosen talked to you about it as a second founding of a remaking of the Constitution, as these ways of holding open these categories that students have some experience with. What's it mean to think of the American Revolution or a founding, and what would it mean to put Reconstruction in that context? I like to also, along with those perspectives, bring a couple of other questions that I think are particularly relevant for students now, for what will become obvious reasons, but that do help us to really understand how the period right after the Confederate surrenders proceeded. And to think about Reconstruction as a place to explore questions about what war is, what wartime means, what war powers are, what war empowers governments and people to do. Also to think about questions about when wars end, something that we still find ourselves caught up in trying to define and to get to the bottom of. If war signifies something, when does it actually end, and how does a nation decide when that closing point has come? From that, a series of questions that continue to trouble public life and public policy about what are occupations and how do they work, and what do occupations succeed at, what occupations have occupations succeeded at accomplishing and struggled to accomplish. And to think of those as avenues into a question that truly troubled the people at the end of the Civil War, which is how do you change a society in which the large number of people with enormous social and economic and political power are fiercely resistant to change? And what tools does a society have to try and create change? And what does it do when it faces that resistance? What one great scholar of the period, Mark Grimsley, has called an insurgency in the South that extended for decades. So what to do when you face these kind of oppositions? But I want to start with those. So those are some of the abstract questions that I think we can attach to. I want to start with a really concrete question. I'll be pulling from my book, which is in the back after Appomattox, Military Occupation and the Ends of War. And I'll also be pulling from my website, Mapping Occupation, which I'll show you in a few minutes. But I want to start with a really easy question, which is, when does the Civil War end? Now, some of you all are going to be thinking lunch must be coming super early today, right? Because, you know, we'll be up and out, and you'll be, at your, finely catered meals in a matter of seconds. Because it seems like, one question that people can get correct, that it seems like it has a very simple answer. And the answer generally comes to this. To this image here, apotheosized as a kind of iconic moment of Lee and Grant meeting at Appomattox. And so if you asked 100 people, of the ones who had an answer, almost all would say it's Civil War ends at Appomattox. And in fact, Kenneth Burns' documentary, with its perfect eye for melodrama, begins with the Wilmer McLean story of the war beginning at Manassas and ending in Wilmer McLean's parlor at Appomattox. And of course, what's amazing about that as an opening to the documentary is that both things are factually untrue. Right? But they're untrue in a way that gives us a signal into what it is, what's so powerful about the myth of how to frame the war. Right? What it means to start with the war on the battlefield instead of the shelling of a defenseless U.S. fort in Fort Sumter, which is obviously to me where the Civil War begins, and what it means to de-emphasize that and to turn it into a struggle on the battlefield, but also what it means to end with this moment, which is clearly, as I'm going to try and explain to you, not the end of the war, what it means to think of the end of the war as a reunification of these brothers who've been fighting on the battlefield. But the Civil War was never constrained in that way, was never purely defined by battlefield fighting, and the end of the war was never understood on legal or political terms to have come at Appomattox. And to understand how this came to be, now it's natural to look back and to think I'm applying standards from our contemporary time, but in fact people at the time were very clear about this. This guy, Francis Lieber, portrayed in a famous book by John Fabian Witt called Lincoln's Code. It should really be called Lieber's Code, but I don't think Lieber's Code would have sold, right? But he writes the Army's first guide to the laws of war. It becomes distributed during the war, in part to justify for a variety of reasons, but one is to figure out a legal justification for the Army's actions in ending slavery and attacking slavery. And it becomes a guide to the Army on how to fight the war under the laws of war. It also becomes a justification for the expansive power the Army uses, because Lieber says that while there are all kinds of limits in what the Army should do, in the end, necessity justifies the ultimate truth of a war is that a nation must survive. And so the necessity can explain or justify all kinds of different things. But Lieber is also, because he's articulated that war can allow armies to do all these things, to free people, to arrest and depose local officials, to arrest civilians, to try civilians, all kinds of things that couldn't be true in peacetime. That no matter how wild or rambunctious our politics get, it's unimaginable that the Army is going to march in and arrest the local judge and empty the jails and throw us in a military jail, that the triumph of civil authority over the military is definitionally what makes the United States, to many Americans, seem a functioning republic, that civilian power might be wise or might be unwise, but it's superior, it's triumphant, but not in wartime. And Lieber said the Army had the authority, as it marched through, not to recognize, to arrest, to try even. And so Lieber, for that reason, became very concerned as the Confederacy was on its death knells in the winter of 1864 to 1865 with the question of when did the Civil War end? And he wrote, both internally into the government and also publicly for public consumption, about this problem. He wrote in May 1865, when does a rebellion end? A war is ended by peace. And so in wars between countries, the timing of the end of the war is determined by treaty. And so at a specific moment, the nations pass from war to peace. They might have an armistice or a truce that puts them in a temporary state of not fighting, but they have a clear moment. And he says, we have to be able to know, if we're not going to live in a military tyranny, we have to know exactly what that moment is at which normalcy returns. And so he says, commonsensically, people think that war is fighting between armies. But he said, that can't be true because we continue to do things we couldn't do in peacetime, even when armies are not fighting. As Thomas Hobbes had written, that war is defined not by fighting, but by the will to fight. So he says, what we have to know is when peace actually recurs. And it does more damage for us to confuse peace than it does for us to blur a line between battlefield fighting and post-battlefield wartime. So he said, but this is then the problem with the Civil War. You can't make a treaty. By definition, in a Civil War, you recognize the national center does not recognize the whole point, the idea that the Confederacy was a body who could make a treaty with them. That was the whole purpose of the war, the so-called Confederate States of America, as Lincoln always referred to them. Not as a nation in and of itself. In fact, Lincoln usually did not use the term Union Army. It was the U.S. Army. The United States survived. The Union Army arises in a way to appease the feelings of ex-Confederates after the war and the triumph of the notion of a Union Army. But they're veterans of the U.S. Army, not of the Union Army. The so-called Confederate States of America, it doesn't exist in his vision. It's an aspiration. So Lieber says, so the only way we could make a treaty with the Confederates is if they won. But if they don't win, if we win, by defeating them, we destroy them as somebody who we could make a treaty with. So he says, so how does it end? How do you end a civil war? He says, some people will say it ends with the end of fighting. And he says, while that seems commonsensical, he says, it is something that upon any reflection is so foolish as to be dismissed. That it cannot end with the end of fighting because he says the wills, the power endures. And so that raises a question. The power, if the U.S. government is going to sustain its powers to arrest people, to take over local government, its powers to suspend habeas corpus without a specific instigating incident, to hold people against judges' writs of habeas corpus, that this power, the continuation of this power, means that the war hasn't ended. So then he says, when does it end? This is, you know, this is a revelation that even geniuses are human, because Lieber says, a war ends with pacification. Well, this is like a perfectly circular argument, right? Pacification is peace, so a war ends with peace. It's a way of, you know, punting, of failing to define it. But he's raising this point that philosophers and legal theorists, and increasingly by 1865 politicians are articulating, which is the war ends, as his friend Charles Dana would say in Boston on July 4th, 1865, in a popular rally, that the victorious nation can hold its opponents in the grasp of war until it has obtained what it wants and has a right to obtain. So when does the war end? The war ends when the U.S. decides it ends. And that reason, it doesn't end at Appomattox. So let's talk about, I want to walk you through, as a lead-in, some different endpoints, what they raise about how the war might have gone, how the end of the war might have come, and then to use that to clear some space to talk about the occupation that came. Because there's a reason why Appomattox endures in our memory. It seems to capture this notion of equals and of respect and honor. There's all kinds of myths that circulate about Appomattox, well portrayed by Liz Varon in her fine book about Appomattox, and which a Grant said upon being asked about whether they met under an apple tree or the exchange of swords, he says, you know, that it would be a fine story if it were true, but that most of the stories about Appomattox were nonsense. They were invented as a mythic way of reuniting people at the end of reestablishing the idea of a brothers' war, rather than a war, a struggle over slavery and a war that had taken on revolutionary implications. So, but we know some really basic reasons why it can't be Appomattox. And one of the really basic concrete reasons why it can't be Appomattox is that Lee does not surrender the Confederate army. He surrenders his army. Why? Because Jefferson Davis has forbidden him to surrender for the Confederacy. Lee doesn't have the power to end the war. He has the power to surrender his army. At first, he raises with Grant the idea, let's meet and talk about peace. And Grant, very shrewd, much shrewder than people, not just brave and stubborn, but also much shrewder than people often give him credit for, much more politically savvy than people give him credit for, Grant responds and says, if he wants to talk of peace, it means that we're going to fight. And he writes back and he says, we can't talk about peace. We can talk about surrender. And that distinction for Grant matters an enormous amount. That Lee can surrender his army, and Grant can accept that, but Grant can't make peace. Lincoln has argued, has told him that that's a political question that belongs to Washington, D.C., not to officers, not to generals. But the other side of it is that Lee also knows this. He's aiming for peace to see what he can get out of Grant, but he knows that he can't actually make peace for the Confederacy because Jefferson Davis has denied it. Why? Because Jefferson Davis, who surely must represent at some level the desire of the Confederacy to keep fighting, is determined to keep fighting. And as he's fleeing south, he's trying to get where eventually he would like to end up is something that people continue to speculate on, possibly Cuba, possibly Texas, possibly Mexico, but somewhere where he's imagining a continuation of the Confederate project outside of Richmond and Virginia. So when Lee and Grant meet, Lee surrenders his army. And Grant has rejected the idea that they'll talk about peace or what the terms of peace would be. He has established a series of understandings about the surrender that do have big consequences, allowing people to keep sidearms and horses and things like that. But they have not said that it's the end of the war. One of the reasons that we know it can't be the end of the war is that another major Confederate army stays in the field. And their surrender occurs later in April after this incredibly complicated series of events that I'll come back to in a minute. Near what's now Duke University in Durham, North Carolina, where another major Confederate army does remains in the field and is chased down by Sherman and eventually surrenders. Now here, this story is sort of one of these remarkable stories that often gets papered over because at this moment you actually do see the possibility that the nation might be turning from war to peace. And you see it in what transpires near Durham, North Carolina, and you also see why that can't work as a national myth of reconciliation. Because as they meet near North Carolina, Joseph Johnston, the Confederate commander, knows that controlling the second major Confederate army, he knows that with its surrender, the real potential of a Confederate project is fading. And he also has access to Jefferson Davis, who is stuck in the Greensboro, North Carolina rail yard trying to get south, but unable to because of the inadequacy of the Southern Railroad system. So he's sending messages back and forth. And when he takes the message that he's prepared to surrender, Davis at first urges him not to. And Johnston says, I, as a commander of this army, I can't send them into a sacrifice. Right? We've lost our ability to defend ourselves. I'm going to surrender the army. But he says, it's also time for you to contemplate surrendering what he wouldn't allow Lee to do, surrendering the Confederacy. Davis attempts to convince his cabinet to launch a full-scale guerrilla war, a kind of never surrender, what Jason Phillips has, you know, articulated as a position of diehard rebels, of people intent on fighting forever for the Confederacy. But his cabinet persuades him not to do this. So reluctantly, Davis gives Johnston the power to make peace. By the time he meets with Sherman, this big instigating event has happened, Ford's Theater that Matt talked about. And Sherman gets the news as he's on his way to meet with Johnston and the commander of the other major Confederate army. And he feels this fear that having heard about Lincoln's assassination, that his soldiers will want to punish and get vengeance upon the other army. And so he's eager to find a way out of it. And he also is, one of these fascinating things that Anne will, is the world's great expert on, and undoubtedly will touch upon in her topics, is that Sherman has this incredibly interesting vision of war and peace. That it was expansive understanding of the power of the government to do almost anything in wartime, but a very sharp sense of when peace came. And unlike Grant and Lincoln and most of the rest of the establishment, Sherman is eager for a very quick return to peace, and it's heightened by the death of Lincoln. So he comes in, he tells Johnston that Lincoln has died. He writes a note to him that Lincoln has died, and then they make a treaty of peace, not a surrender. He says, peace from the Potomac to the Rio Grande. Okay, so this could be the end of the war. Unlike Grant, Sherman says peace. Unlike Grant, he establishes political terms. Those political terms are that the governors of each state stay in office, all the local authorities stay in office. Doesn't say anything about slavery. It's possible to imagine under Sherman's outcomes that some form of slavery, certainly not 4 million people enslaved by this point, but some form of slavery enduring. And it guarantees their political rights. It's solving not just our army's going to fight, but what powers exist. He sends this up to Washington, D.C. And if this were the end of the war, you would imagine that Washington, D.C. would have accepted it. But instead, Grant, upon reading it, his heart sinks because he knows it's the catastrophic mistake, one of the most catastrophic mistakes, political mistakes, of the Civil War. He takes it into the cabinet. The cabinet not only denounces it, but denounces Sherman. And the cabinet wants Sherman fired, humiliated. Not only do they reject the terms, they want Grant to go there and to displace him and to show that he's not even reliable to carry out orders. Cabinet releases this to the press, and Sherman's offer of peace and its soft terms chases the funeral procession off the front page of national newspapers. It's such a scandal, and it's so dramatically out of tune with the national mood. So if we were looking in 1865, did they think it was the end of the war? The idea that Sherman's offer is rejected unanimously by the cabinet and by Andrew Johnson, who sells out Reconstruction in all kinds of ways, but not on this. And so the idea that we have, that the war comes to a close in April 1865, is an idea that we impose later, not one that rises up from the time period. Why do they reject it? Well, they reject it because of what peace would have meant, those things that Sherman promised, that people would be able to keep their judges, sheriffs, their governors, their laws, that they would be restored to normal powers in relation to the army and the soldiers. This is going to have all kinds of powerful implications that I'm going to come back to in just a moment, and all kinds of ways in which we can look forward as we get to the end and we think about what Reconstruction didn't accomplish. Sherman's offer gives us a vision of how little it would have been possible to accomplish. Because under his offer, not only do you not have black enfranchisement, you not have a 15th Amendment, you never would have had a 14th Amendment, you might even have persistence of some form of slavery, or at least of state laws justifying slavery, because the 13th Amendment hasn't been ratified yet. So a real sense of how little, if it were only, as some historians say, if this were only a war of union, Sherman's offer captures that, union only. But we know that the fact is it was not a war by this point only over union, and we know it because even the most conservative people in the cabinet, and Andrew Johnson, one of the most conservative U.S. politicians in the country, reject that idea unanimously. It can't be solely about the end of the Confederacy's will to fight. And we'll come back to that, more of what that opens up in just a minute. But even that doesn't end, even that surrender doesn't end the process of surrender. Over the next weeks, different Confederate armies surrender. So when they reject it, they send Grant down to order that Sherman can only authorize a surrender. And so Johnston withdraws the offer of peace from the Confederacy and surrenders his army. That means there are other unsurrendered Confederate armies in the field. This is where Juneteenth and the question on Juneteenth comes from in Texas. And we'll come back to why the relationship between the U.S. power occupation and the end of slavery. But Juneteenth is the proclamation of that the U.S. arriving at Texas is in position to accept the surrender of the Confederate authorities who remain in Texas. Many of them had fled to Mexico. So this is one interesting way of thinking about the end of the war. So Juneteenth comes from June 19th, the U.S. Army arriving on Galveston Island and reading aloud the general orders that says that that slavery is ended and the Confederacy has surrendered. Even that's not the end of the war. The last surrender of the war, and one of the things that reminds us of the incredibly complicated and various natures of the Civil War, actually occurs in Indian Territory with the surrender of Confederate-affiliated Native tribes to the U.S. that instigates its own interesting period of U.S. occupation of what's now Oklahoma and of a U.S. imposition of the end of slavery upon the Confederate aligned of the Native tribes, and that starts a whole new passage moment in Native policy in the U.S. So at Appomattox, you have all these armies that not only are fighting at Appomattox, but continue to be fighting or open to fighting. So why then to go toward back to why Sherman's proposal was rejected? What were the powers that the U.S. Army thought it needed? And where was the U.S. Army, and why did the politicians believe they needed to expand it? At the period of surrender, you can see from these dots, the U.S. Army is all over Tennessee, which had been well occupied during the war, and along certain rail lines and the Mississippi River. And it's starting to push into the Carolinas and to push down into Virginia. But you can see that there are large parts of the U.S. South, of the Confederacy, and this goes to the question of why the delays in a place like Texas, there are large parts of the Confederacy where the Army's not present at all. And if it's peacetime, then the Army has no place going into those places and doing anything. So by rejecting peacetime and opening surrender, and focusing on surrender, the U.S. government holds open the idea of what will happen, which is that from this concentration in March and April, by May, the Army has started to spread out across the Confederacy. So in essence, if we end the war at Appomattox, we lose a major campaign, which is the movement of the Army into areas that the Confederacy had never lost control of during the war. And as you'll see, so why do they do this in May? They do it in May because the U.S. government is not at all convinced that Confederates have stopped fighting. We have, and historians have partly been responsible for this, taken on a myth that's tied to Appomattox that the Confederacy, seeing defeat, was willing to accept anything that came. But they did not believe that at all. In fact, they're highly aware of the possibility that returning soldiers will start an insurgency, like other demobilized armies have throughout history, and that they'll attack directly U.S. Army officers, and that they'll attack loyalists. And the reason they believe this is because it's true, right? That in the years after the surrender, ex-Confederates will attack and murder U.S. Army soldiers in uniform, as well as anyone suspected of being a loyalist, meaning white loyalists in the South as well as freed people. And an estimate that compiled in 1888, that 50,000 African Americans are murdered in the South between 1863 and 1888. So it is an insurgency and it's an armed attack. The U.S. government is worried about it because they have reason to understand that even if the Army units are breaking up, that doesn't mean the will to fight of the Confederacy is gone. So the first thing they do is they march out in this additional campaign. They march across the South and they say, we're in charge. You're not in charge. The thing that Sherman's agreement would have denied them. They say, and these orders come down from their commanders, tell them you can work through their judges or their sheriffs if you want to, but if you don't want to, you don't have to. They serve at your will. This is impossible in peacetime. Like I said, there's no conceivable way in peacetime the Army can come in and to say the judge of this county or the sheriff of this county is deposed and to take over the jail. It requires a special emergency situation. But this is put as normality across the South. You're not in charge, we're in charge. That means we determine who can be arrested. We determine we can set rules, some of the rules they set. normal in wartime, but abnormal in peacetime, what clothing you can wear. Can you wear your Confederate uniform? By military order, they say no. Can you wear uniform, ribbons, badges? No. So they're governing it as an occupied place because they're worried about a rebellion. And that's the first stage of why it can't move to peace, that the army marches in and it says, the U.S. government, not your local officials, is in charge. We are the instrument of the U.S. government, and you don't have, you can get your judges, can issue writs, you can complain politically, but you don't have the power to overturn our power. We are the law. The ultimate question, legal theorists said, is that people ask about government is who makes the law of the land where I live? And the army wanted to, the U.S. government wanted the army to march through to send that signal that it, the U.S. government, not local white Confederates, make the law of the land for that time period. So this explains this movement, why you go from a relatively light concentration in areas the U.S. Army had not reached to moving in. But it doesn't fully explain the next one, and I'll show you these in my interactive site in a few minutes, which is why the Army continues to march out across the summer and why it continues to hold hundreds and hundreds of locations throughout the summer and early fall. Because having marched through once and said, we're in charge, you could easily imagine the Army might have marched on, and they don't. And the reason for this is the second thing that emerges as a problem of the coming of peacetime, which is the end of slavery. And so this relates to the question that Matt raised about the end of slavery and about Keisha's question about why it takes so long to come to Texas, which is that what the Army finds as it marches out into these different outposts, eventually covering almost 1,000 places in the U.S. South, more than 750 in the Confederacy, marching into not only major towns and cities, but as you can see, 70 in Georgia alone, into tiny places that are now hard to find on a map. What they find is that slaves and ex-slaves come up to them and tell them, slavery is not dead. Not just oppression or racism, but slavery has not died. And they teach these officers, as they march through, a concept that has been brewing among anti-slavery people throughout the war, which is the difference between statutory legal freedom and practical freedom. And this notion circulates from these discussions of slaves and ex-slaves coming to the Army, through the Army hierarchy, and onto the floor of Congress, where this term practical freedom emerges in the debates over the 14th Amendment and the Civil Rights Act. What does it mean when they say we don't have practical freedom? What they say early in the summer is, in fact, not just oppression exists, but slavery exists. That people are being restrained, they're being, in Texas, bought and sold, in other parts of the South, less so over the summer, but continues to be so. That masters are holding on to them, exerting their powers that they have in slavery, and telling them that they're not free and that they'll never be free. That with the end of the war, the power of the Emancipation Proclamation, a wartime proclamation, will end. They'll sue and regain their rights to their slaves, and that the people who are not freed by the direct act of the U.S. Army will, in fact, remain their slaves. And so many white Southerners believe this, and they're fighting desperately in the period after the surrender to retain as many people in direct slavery as they can. So what ends it? This becomes then a second project of the post-surrender U.S. Army, which is to march through not just to county seats, but to march onto plantations. And to march onto plantations, to read aloud the Emancipation Proclamation or other orders ending slavery, but, and this becomes the crucial thing, also to remain proximate. So that if people are continuing to be held in slavery, so that ex-slaves have a place of recourse. What practical freedom captured was the idea not just that freedom needed to be said on a piece of paper, parchment guarantees, but that it meant access to someone with enough power to override the masters. And it reminds us of what's going on in these moments, not just in Texas, but across the South over the summer of 1865 as the Army is marching through. It's not that they're bringing news of emancipation. Slaves have known about it for years. They're not convincing the slaves they're free. They've known, and they, if you read through the memoirs of people like Booker T. Washington, who writes about this in his childhood as a slave, as well as many other people, that they talk about how, for how long slaves have been talking about the meaning of freedom, the coming of the army, the, what those proclamations, what those presence of U.S. Army soldiers on plantation does, what their presence does, is to tell the masters that slavery is over. And slaves are very clear to the army. They don't need the army to come to tell them to be that they want to be free or what freedom means. They need the army to come and to tell the masters. And the key of that is not just to ride and leave, which is possible, but a presence near enough that if the masters disobey the law, the slaves have, ex-slaves have some counterweight, someone to go to. And that's why presence matters so much. Because you're talking about people in an area. I mean, Jefferson Davis couldn't even get, you know, it took Jefferson Davis, you know, weeks to get from Richmond to Greensboro, right? Slaves, and that's, you know, as the president of the Confederacy, you're talking about an area where slaves' ability, ex-slaves' ability to travel long distances is highly constrained, partly because of their special challenges of a lack of money, but also because it's a whole region with a relatively less developed transportation infrastructure, much of which has been damaged by the war. So they want soldiers to stay close enough that they can reach them by walking. And commanders start to write up and to say, how long can we stay? And how long can we stay spread out? Because if you want me to follow your orders, I'm going to need to have people staying in almost every county so that the ex-slaves can come and reach us and to tell us what's going on, because otherwise we have no idea. And over, they say that it is not proclamations that will end slavery, it is bayonets, right? That white Southerners have to be convinced by force to give up slavery because they're not accepting it as a proposition of law. And they write as they go through, even in places like Arkansas, forgetting about Texas, which is a special circumstance, June and July, months after, they write very matter-of-factly, rode into town, found these people held slaves. That doesn't even require explanation. The first time in Arkansas they really have to explain how people are being held in slaves, what's the method of it, comes that fall. For the summer, it becomes very matter of fact for officers to find that white Southerners are holding people as slaves in Texas into the winter. Rumors of slave sales even in the winter of 1865 to 1866, and pockets of people being held as slaves into that winter. To see this, and one fascinating story that captures this, another one that's available on the Documenting American South website that Matt talked about, is the amazing story of Lewis Hughes, who writes a memoir long after the war and who's portrayed there in an image when he's in Michigan long after the war. He's held a slave in Appomattox, which is near Tupelo, famous, obviously, for Elvis Presley. He's held a slave in Pontotoc. He's made multiple efforts to escape during the war, and each time been captured because the Confederacy is sending soldiers in to patrol, let's see if I can avoid falling down, in to patrol the areas, you know, to patrol the roads and to keep slaves from moving toward Memphis, where the U.S. Army has occupied the city and established a large fortress. He says that they find out about the Confederate surrender, but that their master continues to tell them, you're slaves, and to patrol the roads, and to prevent them from moving and from escaping, and that they're continue to be held in, as slaves weeks after the Confederate surrender, even though everybody knows about it. The method that he takes gives a real insight into what it's going to take for slavery to end, and the incredible efforts that he takes, but also the other force that's needed. Under cover of darkness, he escapes with another slave named George Washington, amazingly enough, and they go all the way from Tupelo to Memphis. There, they go to the U.S. Army post and one of the provost marshals. They say, we want to be free. And he says, congratulations, right? You are free. And they say, no, you don't understand. We want to be free, and your order is going to mean nothing. We need force. And he says, we can't spare people right now. They've got all kinds of things. Memphis is a cauldron itself. And he says, but go back in. And he says, there's an army post in Senatobia. At this point, there's not yet one in Oxford, though that'll be coming. As they come into Senatobia, coming back down, they get an experience that shows the fluidity of U.S. Army views of the end of slavery. When they get into Senatobia, African Americans there say, don't go to the officer. He's been socializing with all the town ladies. and you can't trust him. Often it's the reverse, but this is their experience there. But they say the enlisted men, especially the ones who are in these tents, will help you. They go there. They're also very savvy, and so they convince them to help by means of paying them, and they pay two soldiers from Senatobia to come with them to the plantation. When they get to the plantation, now they've got U.S. Army, this is after the surrender, they get to the plantation with soldiers behind them. The plantation owner says, I'm going to get my gun. Let's see them try. And, you know, the soldiers come up and say, you know, we're here to free them by the power of the U.S. Army. And he says, let's shoot it out. He's ready to fight, continuing to fight to hold his people in slavery against active duty U.S. Army officers, not just against his people. And they say, incredibly savvily, they say, awesome, because the other thing we're going to need is a lot of feed because we have 80 cavalrymen about, you know, 5 minutes behind us. And at this point, he gives up. And the lesson for that, for Lewis Hughes, is it's not an order. It's not even the presence of the U.S. government. It's overwhelming force. What kills slavery? Overwhelming force. The masters aren't saying, do I have the right to do this? Or am I violating a rule? But am I going to be forced to abandon? And it reminds us of the incredible power of slavery. We used to have a vision that slavery was weak and on the verge of dying. But we're much more attuned to both the profitability and the incredible power of slavery, both in American life and the American economy, but also as an incredibly powerful institution. Many people at the beginning of the war thought that it would dissolve upon impact. But at the war's end, there remained roughly 2.7 million people who had not reached U.S. lines, who might be covered by the Emancipation Proclamation, but couldn't act upon it. And breaking down that form of slavery was going to take this kind of direct force that we see in the life of Lewis Hughes. He takes his family and he moves to Memphis because there's a large army post there. As that army post, and in ways I'll get to, reduces, he ends up moving to the north. So he's not in Memphis, I don't believe, at the time the next year of the misnamed Memphis riot, which is a racial massacre, and which Memphis, for the first time ever, is on the verge of finding a way to commemorate. At this, the 150th anniversary of it in 1866. So that problem of where are there soldiers and are enough should remind us of something else that floats through every occupation, but that also for many people, that I skipped over, but for many people would be a sophisticated answer to when does the war end, which is its symbolic ending as this is going on in the Grand Review in Washington, D.C. in May, where on two successive days, the U.S.'s main two armies march through the Capitol streets, through parades. They parade in front of the president and the commanding officers, and many of them go from there to go home. And this is a powerful moment of symbolically ending the war, stitching together not North and South, but the two vast U.S. armies, the Eastern and the Western one, stitching them together in the U.S. Capitol, and people going from there to go home. Because it is, in fact, true that for many people, the end of the war might not come with battlefield fighting, but it does come with the muster out. This is an image of mustering out in Little Rock, Arkansas, though tellingly it's not in 1865, but it's in spring of 1866. So how do we make sense of this? What's happening to the number of soldiers, and how does that help us to understand what's going on in terms of the U.S. Army in the South? So as you can see here, the number of soldiers in the army drops dramatically. And by this estimate, there's been something correct about the change in U.S. policy over 1865, which is from roughly a million people at war's end. The army moves into one of the most incredible bureaucratic operations of mustering out 820,000 people by the end of that summer, more than 900,000 by the fall. So this vast volunteer force is largely sent home over the course of the summer and early fall. But the dotted, and that's what the blue line shows, the dotted red line shows what the U.S. Army is doing at the time, and it shows this thing that raises the complications of what's going on during occupation, which is that even as the Army is sending people home, it's sending its Army to more and more places. Those of you with experience in military policy might not be surprised at this contradiction, that's getting fewer resources and told to do more things at the same time. Why? Partly, you know, it's, you know, endemic to the challenges of policy. Partly it's because politicians are responding to two different pressures. From the South, they're hearing from their officers about the continuity of slavery. But from the North, they're hearing from people saying, when is my son, husband, a very understandably father, coming home? And they're solving it by trying to do both things at once. Tell the Army to do more things and send lots of people home. And through the summer, this actually, in some ways, functions. Because no one thinks that, A, they're going to be able to keep a million people in the Army throughout the war, you know, throughout Reconstruction. And B, they don't think they need a million people in the South. And in fact, commanding officers are very clear that something along this September line, at which you might have 80,000, you could actually regulate the South with that. But what happens, and this speaks to internal political things I can develop at great length if you're, you know, if you want in questions, is that the Army continues to reduce over the fall. And that's then when commanders start to say, now I don't have enough people. Now if I send people out, I'm sending them out into suicide missions. To send three people out into this town is to send them to be killed, right? That if I send them there and they try and do things, the Confederates will attack them. And they start pulling people in. And so it's over this fall. Some of this has to do with the intricacies about Grant and what he misses out on in the summer and his slow realization, so that it really is not until January, the return of Congress in December, and Grant's coming around to this position in January of 66, that you see a real effort to save the Army from getting any smaller and to preserve its capacity in the South. So what you see then is that over the winter, you go from here, from the fall, a very widespread occupation, to a hollowing out, so that in places like Tennessee, out of the countryside, into the area around Nashville. You see there's also a huge amount of different standards by different commanders. So in South Carolina, much more concentrated in the upcountry than other places. But the Army is becoming in much of the U.S. South, more and more dispersed. And so that you see then over the summer, as Andrew Johnson's policies of 1866 are really starting to have an impact, that the U.S. Army is withdrawing, staying just on rail lines, and so that by the late summer, it's almost entirely out of this countryside. And what's the impact of this? Well, we can understand the impact of this. We can understand the impact of this by a story about Peter Price. Peter Price is a freedman, and it raises the question, A, of what do the Army can do in 1866 to 1867, and B, what are the limitations on it? He's a freedman in central North Carolina. He works in 1866 for a local planter. He had been a slave. He had works for a local planter, and he comes in. At the end of in December, he decides he wants to move to a different planter, and so he moves. He comes back because the crop is still drying to be sold. He comes back early in 1867 to get his share of the proceeds, as it was promised under contract, and his landlord says that he was not getting anything. So Price then walks. He walks something like 20 miles to the nearest post at which Veterans Reserve officer, an injured soldier officer during the war, is posted there for the Freedmen's Bureau, this wing of the Army that's used as especially a gathering place for freed people to assert their rights and to get someone to broker and to act on their behalf. So he walks in. He faces, in some ways, one of the most powerful people, interesting people imaginable, and someone seems perfectly primed to help him, which is a guy named Hugo Hillebrand. One of these amazing, but you know, actually somewhat common Civil War stories. Hugo Hillebrand was Hungarian. He had fought in the 1848 revolution in Hungary for Kossuth. He had fought for Garibaldi in Italy. So the U.S. He had lived in the U.S. Civil War, in the U.S. in between. He leaves Italy to come fight for the U.S. During the American Civil War. It's his third revolution. He's brutally injured, but he doesn't want to be decommissioned. He chooses, he elects Freedmen's Bureau service, and he's an active proponent, not just the end of slavery, but of the construction of the rights that would be practical freedom. So immediately he writes out a order for the landlord to return his crop. Good, like the story with Lewis Hughes. Peter Price walks back. He takes this order to his landlord. The landlord throws it on the ground and says that Hillebrand that he would see Hillebrand in hell, basically. That he would not intend to be governed by no such laws, and that the Army could send thousands of soldiers, and he did not intend to be governed by no such laws. Price goes back to Hillebrand and says, all right, it's time to enforce it. And Hillebrand says, I have five people. Last year, a U.S. soldier was murdered on the highway. And when I went to go get him, the townsmen stopped me because they thought I would be murdered in uniform going to get him. And when I asked them to come help me, they wouldn't. So I had to wait days with the rotting corpse of a U.S. Army soldier on the highway to collect it. So he says, I can't even protect my own men. I can't even protect my own corpses. If we go out there, we're going to die. And so he says, here's what you need to do. You need to ask for help. So Price, in this incredible political education, begins riding up the chain, asking for help. But by this point, the army has moved all the way to Raleigh. It's out of sight from where he can get to, and he's not able to get the help he wants. And as far as we know, he ends up never being satisfied. And this is the situation in 1866 when we get these moments where we can imagine the war actually ending. That in April 1866, Andrew Johnson issues a proclamation saying that except for Texas, which is a special case, that he doesn't exactly say that the war is over, but he says that resistance has ceased, and he comes close to saying the war is over. But he doesn't actually, even in April 1866. But later, the U.S. Supreme Court will say this is the legal end of the war. What's interesting is that at the time, actually, most lawyers didn't think so, because the Supreme Court Chief Justice came and said, in your order, your proclamation, you didn't actually say that habeas corpus has been restored and that the Army has to obey civil officials. And Johnson says, I didn't say it because I didn't mean it. And so even after this, the Army is utilizing war powers on the ground, and that starts to fade over the summer, and Johnson issues a follow-up proclamation that includes Texas and seems to signal the end of the war in August. But then we get a different question of how to end the war, which is that when Congress returns after having passed, when in that spring of 1866, when Congress passes the 14th Amendment, the question is raised. They have not seated the Southern states in Congress and the Confederate states in Congress, and many Republicans say the war ends when Congress returns them to. When they are represented in Congress, we're at peace. And this is operating off of something that we've lost track of, but was a powerful idea in the 19th century, which is that Congress controls the war powers, not the president. And it was a source of struggle between political parties. Whigs had tended to believe more in the power in general of Congress over the executive. Many Republicans were former Whigs. During the war, it's a source of some struggle between Lincoln and Congress, though in certain ways Lincoln also defers to congressional, certain types of congressional authority. And Congress says, why aren't we seating them in Congress? Because we're still at war. When does the war end? When we seat them. And increasingly, Grant and other high military officers utilize this formulation. How long can you use military power? Till Congress restores them to the Union and peace is restored. Now, frequently by 1866, he's saying, but don't get too out in front of yourself or over your skis. He doesn't literally say over your skis. So this question then dominates that part of Congress. Will the South be restored and on what terms? And in the spring and summer of 1866, as Congress, after having fought and overridden these vetoes by Johnson of a Freedmen's Bureau bill that explicitly continued the powers of war and explicitly continued wartime, and which he vetoes as an act of extension of war into a period of not war, and a civil rights bill that creates a peacetime application of civil rights but gives the Army authority to be called out to enforce these civil rights, as Johnson vetoes both of those and the Congress overrides them, they're trying to find an ultimate solution because they know that politically it's challenging to say nobody likes to run saying we're continuing the war. And so they're looking for a way out, but what are the terms that they can extract from the South? And the 14th Amendment emerges as one possible set of terms, that if the South accepts the terms of this 14th Amendment, will that establish the possibility of the end of the war? And in fact, Tennessee passes the 14th Amendment while Congress is in session and is restored. But interestingly, even in that summer, Congress, under the guidance of Thaddeus Stevens, explicitly rejects the idea that any state that passes the 14th Amendment is back in Congress. And they explicitly add to Tennessee, they're restored for all of these reasons, of which passing the 14th Amendment is just one. And Stevens, as Congress leaves, tells them why. And he says, we're not setting peace terms because we're holding open the possibility that when we come back in the fall, we'll still need these powers of war, and we're going to determine when it ends. He's a radical, but the person he's been aligned with, William Fessenden of Maine, much less remembered, and who was known as a moderate or conservative, had over the course of the spring also come to a similar conclusion. He writes to his father as Congress is debating the 14th Amendment, and he says, we have the authority, and we're not going to let go of it just because the president says so. We're only going to let go of it if the people make us. And so in October and November of 1866, midterm election, Johnson runs saying they're going to continue the war. The Republicans run saying he's going to let the Confederates back into control, and the Republicans win. And so they march, come back in, as Stevens had predicted in December, and they put the South explicitly under military rule. And military reconstruction emerges in this sense out of a set of occupation policies developed by Johnson, but that he wanted to end and they want to extend. And so they continue those powers. The Army doesn't have to obey state writs of habeas corpus. The Army can overrule and even arrest and depose local officials. They depose sets of governors again. And the Army can eliminate discriminatory laws. And it's the Army rules that allow, for the first time, black jurors in the South. And the Army will oversee something new. The Army will oversee the registration in order to ensure that African American men can be registered to vote in the South. And this establishes a new set of peace terms, which is the set of peace terms are that once these new governments with African American participation not only ratify the 14th Amendment, but write new constitutions, then they're back in. And that'll be the first set of in June and July of 1868, helpfully timed to be just before the presidential election. These new Southern governments come back online and are brought in, but not all of them. It's enough that when Grant runs for president, he makes a slogan, let us have peace. Like, we got peace terms now, he says, and the Democrats want to start to restart the war in order to overthrow what we've done in the South. But in Texas and in Virginia, and in Mississippi, those states don't actually come back into the U.S. Congress until 1870, and in the case of Georgia, until 1871. And in 1871, 10 years after the start of the war, when the last Georgia representative is brought in and admitted, because Georgia had, in the fall of 1868, voted to expel all of its black legislators and to argue that there was no rule that said that African Americans, even if they could vote, could serve in the legislature. The Congress had restored military power there. 1871, when Georgia's brought back in, Congressman yelled, let us have peace, which Grant had said in 68, and which Johnson had been saying from the winter of 65 to 66, but then legally is restored in 1871. Now, of course, as you know, peace is not the same thing as utopia or perfection. And in fact, some congressmen, even at this point, and some freed people will say, we're moving too fast. Because the Klan is spreading across the South, and this insurgency to overthrow voting and civil rights is spreading. They're highly aware of this. And so the struggle then over the next decades will be, how much power does the federal government have in peacetime? If it can't just send the Army in to depose officials, if your sheriff is a Klan member, as happens throughout the Carolinas, what power does the U.S. government have? And in a series of acts that extend states of emergency, essentially, they empower Grant in the Ku Klux Klan Act to put states under temporary martial law and to arrest people. But as these powers fade over the 1870s, and they end with the Posse, in some ways they end with the Posse Comitatus Act, at the end of the decade, we see then the resolution that the alternative end of peace terms is the U.S. Army and the U.S. government withdrawing from much of the South. So that remains an open-ended question. It's no accident that when Eisenhower is trying to decide how to respond to the federal judge's order of the integration in Little Rock, Arkansas, that his lawyers go back to these Reconstruction laws in order to argue why he has the authority to make sure the law is enforced. Because this problem has been circulating for almost a century. What to do if the laws on the books don't have an impact on the ground. And it's based on those laws, as well as some others, as Michael Vorenberg and others have written, that Eisenhower calls the 101st Airborne into Little Rock, so that you get the close-in image of her being led in by a U.S. Marshal, and if you pull back, you see that it's happening because there's a surrounded by the 101st Airborne. And this reliance upon military power there and in Oxford, Mississippi with John F. Kennedy and other times. But of course, this is in certain ways an even more depressing story, right? That this change, this question that we raised of how do you make permanent change in a society resistant to it, that both Grant and Eisenhower at some level came to the conclusion of force. But force is a highly impractical way to make permanent change, and it raises great questions about how to sustain change on the ground. If a constitutional amendment can't do it, if laws can't do it, how do you actually remake a society and whether it's possible to? At the end of the war, after his term in office, Grant was asked by an interviewer what he thought the U.S. should have done. And he said, we should have kept them under military law for decades. He said, but we couldn't do it because politically the American people wouldn't support it. And so we were left with these half measures. But the problem in that sense was that the power that he believed it would be a generation, at best, until people would come around to this new way of thinking. And that led him to very melancholy notions of what's possible and of how to make change in the South. I want to quickly walk you through the use of the website, and then I'll make sure to leave time for questions. So the front page of Mapping Occupation gives you sort of an overview of what's there and also a bit of overview of the use of the Army in occupation during Reconstruction, and there's a series of different slides that take you through and tell you how to use it. But if you click the complicated but cool part of the map is on the exploratory map. And so what this has is that each of the dots here from May 1865 until December 1880 represents a different U.S. Army post. And so through this, you can start to get a sense of where the Army is. So to your question of why Texas, well, there's your answer. There is no Army in Texas in May of 1865. People know about freedom, they're running away and claiming their freedom, but there's not someone else that can step in against the planners. So you can run through, first of all, just the different types of units and see the spread over the summer. And what it means is they spread out month to month. And so then you can start to see in 1866 how this withdrawal happens. On each of these, you can stop. And it doesn't have as much information. We're aiming to expand it, but you can stop and it'll tell you where, how many troops, what kinds of troops, whether they're African American or white, as well as infantry, cavalry. And so you can play it out through the time. So the narration that I gave you, here's the sort of height of Johnson. Now we're back to military reconstruction, which doesn't pass till March, but the Army's already re-expanding in 1867 in order to register people and to reassert the powers of the U.S. government. And you'll see as then we come through the winter and the constitutional conventions in the South with these newly remade biracial governments, that with the restoration of southern states, the Army will start to withdraw again in 1868. It spreads then. If you're able to follow, it spreads in October. Why? To be present at the polls in the presidential election. Not in Georgia, and in fact, almost no African Americans are able to vote in Georgia in the presidential election. Elsewhere, it spreads in order to protect people at the polls. And that raises a question of if they can, of what will happen when people are not able, when they're not able to send soldiers at the polls. Here you can see Texas finally getting heavily occupied in 1868 to 69. The restoration of soldiers spreading out a little bit more in Georgia. And in Virginia, 1870, they come back in. And the lines in Texas, which is a fascinating story, though far from here, start to move from protecting freed people in the plantation belt to moving out to the frontier and fighting Indians. But then we see a restoration in 1871, and this is the first movement against the Klan of the sending the 7th Cavalry into different parts of upcountry South Carolina, especially into central Kentucky. So this other sort of front and a sort of post-Civil War use of the Army to suppress the Klan in 1871. You'll see those soldiers leave in 1872 to go back to the West. And this is another project that we have, is to show actual movements between South and West, because the 7th Cavalry has this incredible history of being sent from West to South, fighting the Klan, fighting against Natives, of course, and then ending with Little Bighorn. So Custer's second to last stand was in my childhood hometown of Elizabethtown, Kentucky, where he's sent to regulate a fight against violence in 1874 to 75. You'll start to see this next reassertion of army power in 74 to 75 against a second wave of not Klan violence, but of vigilante violence, movement up the river into Mississippi and the rail line. And you'll see now we're about to the threshold election of 1876, where you'll see one last time where the army expands around the presidential election. And the incredibly contested and complicated presidential election, and then a retreat. Now, many textbooks say the Army leaves the South after the so-called Compromise of 1877. As you'll see, that's not true. It remains, but in highly withdrawn form. In South Carolina, the Army at the end of the occupation actually just marches 6 blocks. It marches from the courthouse square to the barracks, as Heather Cox Richardson has written. But the Army remains present in the South, but in highly constrained terms, and then it wraps up in 1878. Now, there are a couple of other features that I'll quickly show you, one of which is that we also, this question that we raised about how people, can people get to the Army, was something we were really interested in. And so we created an idea of where the Army could reach. And these checkerboards allow you to kind of make our best guess based on where the railroad lines are and also the number of cavalry versus infantry, that infantry, their ability to march there and back is much less than cavalry, of what parts of the South we can imagine in different months, freed people living there might actually be able, the Army could reach them. So not the Peter Price question, can they reach the Army, but could the Army respond? And it's interesting to see how quickly these start to retract and to get centered around train lines as we go through 1866 to 67, and of how many of these white spaces are places that we call almost literally ungoverned. The restoration of military reconstruction allows for this reimposition. So that's one of the sort of cool features. Another is we asked what's the counter question, which is where could freed people reach the Army? We're assuming that most of them don't have access to horses or trains, and so that you can see this is just sort of a bubble outside. And the interaction between those questions, where is it that freed people are going to be able to reach the Army? How many parts of the South, including the Black Belt, where even in 1867 they couldn't? And what happens to those areas as the soldiers move, so that you see whole sections of states become essentially abandoned. You can also plot it against rail lines, if you were interested in that, and a reconstruction of southern rail lines in the period. And you can also plot it against either the percentage of black population, so you can see the relationship of the Army to where African Americans are, which is direct, right? They stay out of places like East Tennessee that are mostly white, and also to presidential elections at the county level, so that you can see where the relationship between Army presence and Republican or Democratic triumph. So it's not as directly. It's more complex. And in certain ways, harder to use than some other digital tools. But it's partly an effort to try and capture how to think about such a complicated question, which is, what did the Army do? How do we understand that? What's it mean to think about the period after surrender as itself a period of wartime? And how can we begin to use the Army presence to ask the question, not about what rights mean by law, but what it means practically to have the ability to have access, to have your rights enforced? So I'd love to, I meant to leave 10, I think we've got 8 minutes exactly for questions. And I would love to take questions, but Matt would very much like for you, or more than like, require you to wait for his microphone. So.
Microphone, I just want to ask the first question. So the simple short answer to the question, when was the end of the war? Do you date it at 1871?
Yes. That I argue the Civil War ends as a legal question in the spring of 1871. The dissolution of the Military District of Georgia and the seating of Georgia's representatives. But in most states, it ends in 1868.
Okay. My name is Steph Chortnoff. I'm a history teacher at Lower Dolphin High School. I want to thank you for giving us a lot of good things to think about and resources here that will make it more accessible for our students. My question is, And you know, I do teach that there is the obvious debate between Lincoln and Congress about you know, running the war and later the Reconstruction effort between Johnson and the Congress. Can you speak to whether or not you think the war itself, and if it carries into Reconstruction, was really an insurrection, or if the South deserves recognition as a separate country, because that complicated how you ran the war and obviously Reconstruction?
No, it's a hugely interesting question, and there's different levels of it. I mean, and the legal background of it, which John Witt does very well in Lincoln's Code, if you're interested, is very accessible. The legal background of exactly what different designations allow you to do is something that he lays out very well and that other legal historians have been. To me, I'm more inclined to see it, you know, as you know, you can tell by my talk, I'm interested in the sort of, you know, almost sort of brute force realities, that this is really a political fight to me as much as an intellectual or legal fight. Right? And that politically, the question that Lincoln asks is that the way the Confederacy will deserve to be recognized is the way the colonists did. If they achieve you know, military success and demand recognition on the world stage, then they'll be recognized as a sovereign power. Certainly, he did not believe that they had a right to secede in that respect, and so that they were, but he did believe in a right to revolution. He thought you should have good reasons for revolution and that the South lacked them, but that it was under, you know, the laws of war as then understood, people had a right to rebel, but they needed to win in order to be recognized. You didn't have a right to declare a revolution and to be seen as a nation. I think the question of how Lincoln and Johnson understood Reconstruction is an incredibly interesting and complex one. There's a lot that gets invested in the idea of if Lincoln had lived, you know, and you know, including you know, the words chiseled on the Lincoln Memorial, which are often misunderstood in his second inaugural. And I think what's interesting is to see that Lincoln's own progress over time and his own interest in shifting from a desire to end the war as quickly as possible to an understanding of the uses of the power of war over 64 to 65, which is part of why he tells his generals not to solve the political questions. He's coming to reconcile with them. But also the sort of incredible number of things that are up in the air in 1865. So I don't think there's a solution in which, certainly Lincoln's a highly adept political operator and an interesting moral thinker, but the problem he faced was so vast that I don't think that simply having a better person in charge would have meant a simple resolution, which sometimes people look back and wish were true. That he still would have faced people who didn't want to get rid of their slaves and who were never going to accept black voting rights, no matter how imposed. And this created that the fight over Reconstruction wasn't a misunderstanding, it was a fight over real principles on both sides that Lincoln would have himself been tied to.
Al Mackey from Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. I see a conflict in the three branches of government here. As far as the end of the war, I see Johnson with his proclamation of August 20th of 1866. Right. I see the Supreme Court agreeing with him in United States versus Anderson, and right. Then I see Congress saying, "No, it's not over yet." Did Congress ever statutorily lay out that they believe that the war is still going on? Did they actually say that in a statute rather than just having it in a debate?
Yes. No, it's a very good question. So if you look at the two places to look would be at the Freedmen's Bureau Act, which establishes a military authority. They don't use the word the war continues. What's interesting is even in 1865, they say until the summer of 1868. They've already thought through that they're not going to want to be, A, that it's not going to be fast, but B, they're going to want to be out of it before the November 1868 presidential elections. And if you look at the language of the Military Reconstruction Act, which declares that the governments are provisional, and don't have validity, and it asserts the authority of the military. That's based on their understanding of wartime. But they don't literally say in the statutes. People do say in debates. What's interesting about the Supreme Court is that the Supreme Court says for legal purposes, and it later constructs this, you know, that there has to be this point of movement in terms of the effect of contracts with the government and so on. So for those legal purposes. But it often says that this is a fiction, and it says the political question is one only Congress can settle, and we can't rule on that. And the reason they can't rule on that is that when there is a challenge to the Military Reconstruction Act and the suspension of habeas corpus that arises from the South, Congress strips away the Supreme Court's jurisdiction. So in this sense, Congress says the Constitution permits us to establish the Supreme Court's jurisdiction. The Supreme Court is not going to hear a case that's going to undermine our ability to close the war. And from then on, the Supreme Court does this dance. We need a legal date, but the political question can only be solved politically.
Okay, maybe one more question.
Greg, you talked about Sherman when you said that he talked peace, but he didn't talk slavery. Mm-hmm. Now, he sat down with 20 slaves and,
yes.
I'm sorry, 20 ministers
yes.
and leaders in Savannah, and yes. they said, because the whites won't accept us as equals,
right.
we simply want our land and to go live in peace.
Yes, yes.
So that was Special Field Order 15. That
yes.
was also rejected. So in a way, he kind of did speak a little
yes.
about slavery without actually talking about slavery.
Absolutely.
Can you talk about that a little bit more?
I should have been clearer. What I meant is in his agreement with Johnston, the survival of slavery wasn't mentioned. Certainly Sherman had, slightly before that, as you say, in the meeting in Savannah, heard from, with the guidance of Secretary of War Stanton, heard from African-American ministers and had been issued, the so-called Sherman's Reserve. So he was interested in those questions, and it's part of the duality of his actions, that in wartime, he clears land, forbids white Southerners from being there, and sets it aside. But only months later, he's willing to make this quick conversion into peacetime, which he knows will strip away those powers. So I think it speaks to his sense that when necessary to defeat the enemy, anything is possible. And once defeated, nothing is possible. And it's that doubleness that the other military officers, including Grant, not all, but most of them, including Grant, and that the politicians reject. So it is one of these interesting ironies. And Anne will be able to point out many of these amazing ironies and contradictions, or not contradictions, of Sherman. That within a few months, he goes from the single most expansive Army Act to create a new sense of freedom to an agreement that seemingly might have allowed for the perpetuation of slavery, and trying to reconcile those aspects of his thinking and of his character is something that continues to challenge historians, but that Anne will make perfectly clear after lunch.
All right, let's see. Thank you. Great.